know what I mean? John Scott Martin, who's dressed as Queen Victoria. So he was sitting in the bar going...
we are not amused.
And then the break, you know, like, so we did, you know, just for fun. And another time in the rehearsal room, we forgot that we were having a technical day. It's when all the technical guys come in, and you've done like 4 days rehearsal, because we always did the filming first. That was the first thing you did to any story before you even read the script. You were doing the filming, you know. And anyway, so we'd forgot that we were having a technical run, as they call it. You know, it's when you crawl around the studio and you've got no props, and you're saying, yes, but doctor, you know, are we through it? And you suddenly think, what am I doing? I've got my head near John's bottom. And yet you're fiercely involved in that moment, you know. Anyway, so we just suddenly decided we were going to take all the props in the room, and we made an aeroplane, and John put on my very thick glasses, right? He was going to be the pilot. And if you saw my glasses, you would not get on a plane with this man. And then we found an old British Airways bag, and you know, and suddenly all the technical boys and the producer and everyone came in. And we just kind of, it was like these children had been caught playing. You know, all the things that we needed for the technical room, we had to dismantle our aeroplane. You know, so most of our fun was like in the rehearsal room. Once you were in that studio, because you know, if you weren't finished by 10 o'clock.
Oh, you said always, yeah.
Well, yeah, put the sprinklers on, honey. You know, out. So there was, you know, you had to be unbelievably focused, and I think sometimes people, you know, we can tell the funny stories, but you have to look at the situation. And also John, this was his very first straight role. This was really, really, really important to John, that he would be able to find, which I think he did beautifully, that the combination between the serious and the light, and, you know, he was an extraordinary, I thought he brought an extraordinary feel to the doctor, you know, it was that ethereal feel. You kind of believed that he was 2,000 years old.
Well, that was my first experience of seeing him as an actor, so I just assumed he was always his leading man.
No.
His James Bond type of actor.
No, John.
You know, going back and learning later on that he was even more known for comedy, it's like...
And radio. Yeah, I grew up doing impersonations of the characters he did on radio. I mean, that was pretty spooky.
So it makes that transformation even more impressive.
So it was very important to him. He'd been very much involved in light entertainment because he could sing, play his guitar, he loved doing cabaret. You know, he was a very different performer. And a lot of people in England didn't know who he was. You know, back then there was and I still think that's rather good, when you see actors being cast in a role like this, that you don't associate hugely with something else. You know, I find that's why I don't like it when they keep using the same actors, because you kind of, in the end, you can't help yourself. You say, oh, look, there's that character from something else. I love
it's that guy from Star Trek.
Yeah, exactly. It's lovely when new people come onto the screen. John is brilliant. And then went on to do other extraordinary things on television.
Did you ever just play with his hair? You ever just played?
Oh, you didn't know about his hair. Did you notice, if you watched that particular thing, John's hair gets bigger as the show goes on? But it was nothing to do with the growth of his hair. It was because I was very naughty. And I just jokingly one day said to him, oh, darling, you're getting a little wool patch right there. Now, John was a man who cared very deeply about how he looked. And anyway, from there on in, the Carmen Rollers were in every single day. And I said to him, Donnie, I was joking, you're not going bald. Made up the hair just got bigger and bigger.
I think it's a rule, though, the doctor has to have awesome hair.
I think so, yes. I've actually just done an audio where that very thing is said. I can't remember exactly what it is, but that very thing is said. It's a vital point that the doctor has to have great hair. Darling,
do you think you'll keep doing Iris for years to come?
Well, it's a character that I would love to do years to come. Let's hope that they do continue to do her, my darling little angel. I love this woman. Because I think she's a great character, and I think she was a wonderful spin-off, and she was perfect for me. You know, absolutely perfect. I've been doing her for 16 years now, so there's probably an awful lot of stuff out there that if you like her, that you can still get that you've never heard before. And I do hope that she continues. I really do, because I think she's wonderful and Panda and the whole concept. But I am doing a new script by Paul on the actual BBC radio, because they want to talk about how Iris was the first time baby. So, you know, for all our banging on about there not being women in that role, hello!
Okay.
Hello, Speaker.
Just curious about your thoughts of stuntmen like Stuart Fell and others who basically had to put on your clothes and do stunts as you.
How does that sound? Stuart Fell had to put on your clothes.
You will have to ask, how did you feel about it?
It was the only stunt that I didn't do myself. But they would not, you know, because they didn't care back then that we did our own stunts. You know, I mean, the first day I was filming, I was taught how to roll, they call it a tuck roll, out of a moving car. And yes, it's going very slowly, but you know, so that instead of having me just rolling into shot, you could see me come out of the car, and it makes it much more dramatic. And I'll have a go at anything because I'm so short sighted, you know, it's like when people say, oh, look how far there is to fall. I don't know. What do I know? So I'm fearless, you know, when I climb down mountains, up mountains, you know, I really don't. And but this was out at sea, and it was up that big mast, and I'd already had the suit that I had. I was told not to get it wet because it was made out of wool, and I did get it wet. And so when I got into the studio, the trousers were up here, and I was like this in it. Because Stuart fell heavy, but they couldn't find a woman who was small enough to do that stunt. But I don't know if anybody's ever seen it, but he does this, does a wiggle. I'm seeing a fur coat leaving, I can see a colour. I love that colour, whatever it is, darling, I want it.
That's like Cookie Monster blue right there.
I mean, I even did, I can't drive because I can't see. And they put me on a motorbike and they said, right, you start it up, and then the stunt guys, who were absolutely brilliant, will catch you. So I got on this motorbike, I think it's in the seatbelts, I get on this motorbike, and the bike goes out of shot, and lo and behold, the boys caught me, thank God. Otherwise, I don't know where I would have ended up. But yeah, dear Stuart Fell, he was a stilt walker originally.
When you were on the show, it was only on for 10 years. Did anybody talk about what the longevity they thought was going to be for the show, like it was going to be on for 10 more years, 20?
No. We had just, in John's era, we'd just gone to 75% adult viewing, i.e. it had gone from being literally a children's program. It was at the highest ratings it had ever had, it just become a sort of cult. So when Tom took over the baton, it went to the next level. But in our day, I mean, when we suddenly realized that there were, you know, fans and things like that, this was all completely new to us. And you don't, when you're in a show, start thinking out. You would these days. But back then, darling, we were a bunch of little innocents, you know. You've got a great thing, you're doing it, bada bing, bada boom, you know.
And 50 years later.
Yes, 50 years later, we say, well, I wonder if it'll keep going. But it is a remarkable show, and as I say to everybody, there is a distinct different feeling when you come to a Doctor Who convention than any other, you know, because when we do these, sometimes there's, you know, Star Wars over there and there's this over there. When you come to something that is very closely Doctor Who, there is a family feeling. You can't really put your finger on it in the same way as we'll never know exactly what makes something so successful.
So you were with two old doctors back shop.
Two old doctors. A couple of old assistants.
Classic. Classic. Like
classic.
Oh, I like any word you want to use, darling.
Two classic Dodgers, one, I guess, newish Dodger.
I know, we're so tied these days. Yeah. Oh, I don't know what the right terminology is. Say whatever you want.
All right, an adjective.
Yeah.
All right. That's an adjective.
Yeah.
I guess, what was the biggest difference you saw between the way they used to prepare for the role versus what you saw with Matt Smith, I guess?
Time.
Time.
Was one of the major things. Budget. Another thing. But in the Sarah Jane Adventures, I can truly just say to you, when I went into that particular side, I mean, if you're looking at, like, who, when I went in, when I was talking to Peter Capaldi, he said, I don't know how you guys did it in the way that you used to do it back then. He said, I don't think I could do it. You know, they have a very, I'm not saying that budget is massive. They still do incredible things. It's not as big as everybody thinks it is. But with the Sarah Jane Adventures, and I went into the TARDIS with Matt, and Russell T had written that incredible line where she said, it still smells the same, because smells are so evocative. And that's exactly what it does. The program being involved in anything like that, it still smells the same. Doesn't matter how many new coats you give it, it's still there.
Aside from that being my favorite episode of the Sarah Jane Adventures, the entire thing was just such a love letter to you know, school. I mean, like, yay Russell T. Davies for that reason. He just, like, applied his fanboyness to the absolute best of his ability.
I'll never get over this, the fact that, you know, you're with Mark Gatiss and you're with Russell T. and then you're on there with Peter Capaldi, and they're actually confessing to being fanboys, because I'm looking at people who I absolutely think are brilliant, you know, everything they produce is brilliant, and it's really hard for me to actually feel this thing that they said, but you don't understand.
You don't understand, Joe Grant was my first crush.
And then Mark Gatiss said, when they did Sherlock, and you see Sherlock winking, when you see Mark Gatiss walking away, and Holmes has just got married, and you hear the music, and rah, 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 and so, and at that moment, you know, and the collar goes up, and it's night time, and, you know, and all the rest of it. And I thought, gosh, that was very reminiscent of the Green Death. And Mark Gatiss speaking, and he said, darling, he said, that was the most traumatic time of my entire childhood. Absolutely, that is exactly what my intention was. You know, to have that moment of the Green Death. So it's really lovely, all the crossovers and the, you know, but it is hard for me to see these incredible actors and writers and producers who are, you know, say, but we're just families, really. You know? It's really hard. It's an amazing show.
We have time for one more, so take
otherwise, us off. We've got a wonderful guest coming onto the stage who's going to be sensible, and he's not going to spill tea all over himself, and he's going to tell you really interesting things, and he's going to behave, and he's not going to lie on the floor a lot. And if he does, I want to be here to watch it.
Right? That's a lot to live up to there.
Our champion is waiting to come out here.
Last question. So when the Terror of the Autons came out and the public got to see you on Doctor Who, did you find your public life change a lot? Did you have to adjust to things? I mean, you hear different people had different experiences with it. I was wondering, what it was like for you, especially the time of the crazes around then?
Well, it was a very different time back then. People did, of course. You know, you were constantly recognized. But I'd been in another television series with an actor who was much loved by a lot of women, so I got a lot of women coming, oh, what's he like? You know, oh, you're so lucky. You know, and then when you come into Doctor Who, but it was very charming. People were very charming, and also, you know, it had come out of being quite a young viewing rating, so there was quite a lot of young people. But, you know, it's nothing like it is of what now. You know, showbiz is very different now in the way that people react to it and so on. But it was when you've never experienced anything else, it's kind of weird and wonderful. But going to work every day was an absolute joy for me, and, you know, but being recognised, it was just a bit strange in an odd way. But nobody, it wasn't as invasive as it is often now. You know, it's very different. But I do find, certainly with Doctor Who fans, they are very respectful when they see you on the tube doing a crossword, you know. And that's a lovely thing, you know. In England, actors, a lot of actors travel on the tube quite comfortably, you know. So it was very different back then. But it was such a cool program to be involved with. But we didn't know then what we do know now. And it must be very hard for people who are that much younger to understand how just it was another job, and a wonderful job with incredible actors and a huge place for a young actress to learn television and television technique and to hear the best stories, and certainly from John, who taught me one very important thing, which is what I should end on, is never spoil a good story with the truth.